this seminar this morning. Brother Moses, please take it from.
Lord, we want to thank God so much for what he has been doing with us since yesterday. Again, we are happy to hear from him concerning the matter he started with us yesterday, and that is taking responsibilities in the home. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we want to thank you for this moment again. We thank you for the opportunity to stand as a man to represent you in our homes. We want to thank you because it is a rare privilege. When we hear you saying, wives, submit to your own husband as unto the Lord, meaning that submission that you are asking the wife to submit to their husband is actually meant for you. And you graciously allow us men even to collect that submission on your behalf. Lord, we want to thank you for making us men. We want to thank you for the grace that you have given us to stand for you in our various homes. We want to thank you for all the support you give to us. Many, many times we run into challenges that we cannot cope with. But when we raise our holy hands and cry to you, we see you answering us. So again today, we are happy to come to you to guide us, to show us how we must build our homes such that it will be in a position to pursue your purpose here on planet Earth. Holy Spirit, we ask you to guide us again in this seminar. Blessed be your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. We want to thank God. Yesterday, we're looking at the real man taking responsibility in the home. And we said that we have to look at this seminar specifically because the home plays a very, very significant role in the purpose of God on planet Earth. Actually, there is no much a man can succeed in accomplishing here without the support of his wife. That is why God, in his wisdom, created the woman to be a help, meet, sufficient for him. So we want to say that the responsibility on the shoulder of the man to make sure that his home runs very well is not something that we can overemphasize, because without it, he will not go far. Where we see that in our world of today, whereas God expects so much from a man who must do something for him, and he has made this provision for us to stand for him, there seems to be men who believe that they can accomplish much even without the support of their wives. And we will have some men who will want to put themselves forward to serve the people. Meanwhile, they have not succeeded in running their homes. God is very, very concerned about that. If he is going to, you know, approve of a man who will do something significant for him that is married, that man must, you know, ensure that his marriage succeeded. He himself, first of all, must succeed at home before he can put himself forward to serve the society. If he is not going to marry at all, that's a different matter altogether. But once a man is involved in marriage, God expects that marriage must be well run. That is why, again, in this seminar, we are looking into little issues that the man must take note of so that his marriage can run well. Yesterday, we started with the spiritual responsibilities. We said marriage is very, very, very spiritual. It takes a man who is spiritual to run a successful marriage. And that's why we were looking at it yesterday, that if you are going to lay a solid foundation to run your home, then you must be strongly connected to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That point is very, very important, that every man must be able to have a functional relationship with God. It is from that relationship that he can, you know, project the Spirit of God into his family. Every father must be able to successfully project the Spirit of God to his family, his wife, his children, and every member of his household. God expects us to play that role as a father. And we say that as a father, we must lay a very strong foundation. We must discover the vision of God, the purpose of God, because every home is expected to accomplish something special for God in their lifetime. And we said once that purpose is discovered, the man must create the enabling environment that ensure that the wife is able to operate properly, the children that God will be giving to them to raise for him, they will be well raised. And we went ahead to look at the role of the man as a husband to his wife. We said the first rule is that every husband is to radiate the love of God, to radiate the love of Christ. And we say such love must of necessity be agape love, a love that is sacrificial, a love that is selfless, a love that keeps giving and giving and giving and expecting nothing seriously in return. And that once you are in a position to give your wife such a love, you will not find it difficult to have her totally submitted to you and helping you to discharge the purpose of God for your life. And we said some other things. I said, in a home where God is giving you a wife and children to nurture for him, it is important that as a man, you create that atmosphere that enable you to be tender and to be compassionate because you are raising human beings. And the last thing we said yesterday, for the sake of those who are joining us today for the first time, is that of the priestly responsibilities of a real man in the home. We said every man has been appointed by God to be a priest in his home. And we took a very good example in the life of Job, who we are told that often he offers sacrifices, praying for his family and praying for his children. And he is saying he's doing that regularly. If peradventure any of them has gone astray from the ways of the Lord. And we also said that it is our responsibility to be the pastors of our homes. Every man, even if you will not pastor a congregation outside, you are supposed to pastor your home. Actually, you are the pastor of your wife, you are the pastor of your children, you are the pastor of your household. And that duty confers on you the responsibility of teaching your family the word of God. And we went ahead to say that basic doctrines of Christianity, they are supposed to be taught to your children and your wife by you ever before they began to learn it in church and in other Christian programs. The doctrine of sin, the doctrine of salvation, the doctrine of the fear of God, the love of God, repentance, death, heaven, and hell. These are very basic doctrines that as a real man who has a family, you must be able to ensure that each member of your family is taking a position on that. That the matter of sin is the problem between God and man. Now, today, we want to move on with the seminar, and the area we want to concentrate on, I target formal responsibilities, or what you may call normal responsibilities, because I discovered that even though man was created to be spiritual, when he fell in the Garden of Eden, God did not take the marriage from him. He allowed him to go with the marriage institution. And so you will discover that all over the world, every culture, they practice marriage. And even in the different cultures, they expect that when a man is going to get married, there are certain expectations. Whether you are a believer or whether you believe in God or not, once you are going to get married, The society itself expects that you must carry out certain responsibilities. Otherwise, you are not yet right to be a husband. So in this section, we are looking at such normal functions, even though they are also spiritual, that is expected of us. And it's so important that because if people that don't even know God are expected to carry out this responsibility, how much more those of us that profess to know God? So under this segment, we'll be looking at the leadership role of a man in his house. The leadership role, and then we'll look at the friendship and the social responsibility of a man to get his home running very well. And then lastly, we'll be looking at some other roles that is expected of a man. Now, leadership role of the real man, you know, in the home. Well, we just like to read one or two scriptures so that we can go on with that. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 1 and 2. It said, He that being often reproached, hardened his neck, shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. Verse 2. When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked beareth rule, the people mourn. Hallelujah. There's another scripture I would like us to read in the New Testament, because we want to talk about the leadership role of a man in his home. And that is 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, it says, let the deacons be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their houses well. Every man is designed naturally to be a leader by God, actually. And for that reason, he is saddled with the responsibilities of leading his family in the right direction. And that is very true. We know that it's not every man that may have opportunity to lead in politics, to occupy a public office, but every man that must have a family, God expects that man to provide a leadership responsibility that will enable the family to function properly. And so we want to outline some of those little critical duties that this man as a leader must play in his home. And I said, the first thing I said here is that he must take charge and leading his family by example. You know, by taking charge, we mean that as a man in his family, whatever needs to be done, you as the man, you must stand up and move on. Move, step forward to do it because you are a leader. You will not wait for your wife to tell you to do something. As a leader, you must stand up to lead on every matter that concerns your family. So that's the first thing. If you are a leader, if you want to be regarded as a leader, you must lead. Lead on issues that are important. Lead on issues that are critical. Even issues that are little things that you think they are not important. As a family, as a family man, you must take that initiative to lead your family, you know, on any matter that will guarantee their welfare. The second thing you must do as a leader is that a leader, whether you are a political leader or you are a spiritual leader or you are a family leader, you must be able to take initiative. You must be a man that can take initiative, a man that can generate ideas, a man that can provoke creative thinking. You must be the think tank of your family. You know, you must be able to bring ideas and say, my wife, this is what I'm thinking. This is the way I think we should go this way. For instance, as a leader, you are the one to think about the schools. You know, ever before you start discussing the matter with your wife, you would have been thinking ahead, okay, among the schools that are in our environment, which of them should we put our children? And you would have done some research to find out which of those schools that your children, you know, can, you know, be enrolled. Every matter that has to do with your family welfare, you need to take the initiative. You need to, you know, generate the ideas. You need to, you know, be ahead of your family so that when you come back to discuss the matter with them, they can begin to draw from your ideas. The other thing is that as a leader, what makes a leader is that he has authority. As a leader, you must assume the authority as the family head. What that means is that you will be exercising an authority for the safety and the security and the protection of your family. Authority of a leader is meant to provide for the welfare, for the security of the people he is leading. That's why you often hear people saying that the first responsibility of every government is to secure its people. That every government that cannot ensure the security of its people will lose the confidence of its people. That begins from the home. Why do we confer authority on the leader? It is because that authority is meant to protect the family. That authority is meant to provide safety for the family. Authority is never to be used for bullying. You know, there are some men, because they are men, they are the husband and they are the father of the family. They use their authority to bully their wives. They use their authority to bully their children. No, as a real man that is standing for God, your authority is to guide your family. Your authority is to protect your family. Your authority is that anything that needs to be done is well done and properly done, and everybody is happy. The next point under leadership is that I said, as a leader, when people are working with you, it is your responsibility to create an enabling environment. You will discover that even as a leader in an office, you know, a leader that does not provide, you know, a conducive environment will usually not win the loyalty of his staff. But if you have a leader who seeks the welfare of his of his subordinate, who is able to accommodate their weaknesses and harness their strength, you know, such a leader will always command the loyalty of his subordinate. And that begins from the home. In a home environment, a husband who is also the father of the family should be able to create a conducive environment that also ensures that every member of the family is growing at their space, at their different level. You know, when you have children of different ages, you will discover that they have their own individual uniqueness, like we mentioned yesterday. It is your duty to make sure that the home environment is suitable for each and every one of your children. There may be some of them that are very smart. There may be some of them that are very slow. There may be some of them that are very, very sluggish. And yet, you are the one to make sure that each of them has the environment within which to operate. And then, as a leader, you must be a man who can inspire. A man that people can work with, and you inspire them, you challenge them. And every wife actually look forward to a man leading him. When you ask some women, what exactly do they need from their husband? Apart from the fact that, okay, they want their husband to love them. One of the things that women will tell you, say, look, I need my husband to lead me. They need a man that can inspire them. When you inspire your wife, when you inspire your children, then it becomes easy for them to follow you. You will inspire them in the matter of serving God. For instance, if you are a a leader in your home, you are the one to wake up in the morning first to do your quiet time. And if there is a family devotion, you should be there and be playing an active role. From that, you know, atmosphere, your wife, your children, they will become inspired. You know, they will see that you want to love God, you want to serve God. They must see you taking the lead in the matter of serving God. If, for instance, you are a leader, you are a husband and you are a father in the home, and even on a Sunday, you go to church late, you know, you don't go to church on time. That cannot be inspiring. And then you are asking your children to go to church. You are shouting on them. That is not inspiring enough. You must, first of all, you know, wake up, you know, take your bath, prepare, and then you cannot ask your wife and the children, oh, let's prepare, today is Sunday. Oh, let's prepare, today is a Bible study. You must be a man who can inspire and challenge his family to love God and be willing to serve him without being forced to do so. You know, sometimes it is because we are not doing enough in that area that several times you hear that children of ministers of God, they are not following their father's footsteps. But God is challenging us to have a change. Now, as a leader, you must not be stagnant. You must be continuously growing in grace and capacity so that as your family also is enlarging, you are able to provide different structures for each of them to fill in the gap. That is very important. A leader that is stagnant, you know, cannot go far. A leader that is stagnant, you know, very soon you will discover that his followers will even start, you know, withdrawing. They will not be able to follow him. And it happens in the family. As a leader in the family, you must constantly be growing. And that has to do with your relationship with God, because when you are, you know, fresh in the presence of God, you cannot be stagnant. You will not experience spiritual stagnancy. You will not experience, you know, stagnancy in wisdom. So as a leader, you must be growing in capacity, in grace, so that as your family is also growing, you will be able to give them, you know, a room for them to operate. Again, as a leader, you must be a man of purpose. A leader must be purposeful. A leader must be focused, and a leader must be stable. A leader must be dependable. This is very important to us as men. You know, if you are going to you are going to raise a generation that should perform better than you, and for that purpose, for that reason, you must endeavor to be focused. That's why we were saying earlier on that you should be able to find out from God, what is his assignment for you? And once you know your assignment, focus on it. Focus on it. Be stable. You know, some men, you know, they are not stable. They start one thing today. After some time, they jump from it to another thing. And when they do that, it becomes difficult for their wives and their children to follow. They don't understand what you are doing. And for that reason, they find it difficult to follow you. When you are stable, you are focused, and you are dependable, you become a followable man. And by that, you also prepare the ground for succession, so that when you are going out of the stage, your children are going to succeed you, they will have a smooth transition. The next thing I said is that as a godly leader, the real man must learn how to apply discipline. Because as a leader, you have authority to inspire, you have authority to develop, you also have authority to discipline. However, when you are disciplining any every member of your family, what we are saying here is that don't be a tyrant, don't apply tyranny, you know, use wisdom to discipline any every member of your family. Because if you are not wise, you do not use wisdom in disciplining your member, you may end up causing damages that may be difficult to heal. So because discipline itself is meant to correct, it's meant to make the erring member to be restored and become more better than before. So as a leader, you must use your disciplinary power wisely. Now, the last thing I want to say on leadership is that As a leader, you know that life is full of ups and downs. There are sometimes there are crises in the family, crises all around you. What is expected of you at that point in time is to be a man of courage, is to be able to stand very strong and give assurance to your family that all is well and that God has not abandoned you. You will need to be very strong. Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 18 said, finally, be strong in the Lord. You see, that's what you see. All these things boil down to your spiritual life. Yesterday, when God was speaking to us in the main message, we're still emphasizing the fact that we must have a personal, functional relationship with God. So during times of adversity, as a leader in the family, you are not supposed to abandon your family. You are not supposed to bring this more discouragement to your family. You are supposed to stand very strong and confront the situation using all the spiritual weapons that are at your disposal until the situation is conquered. Right? The next thing we want to look at is the friendship and social responsibility of the real man in the home. What I call the friendship and social responsibility of the real man in the home. I want to read a scripture, John chapter 15. John chapter 15. We see what Jesus said about this. John chapter 15, verse 15. He said, henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. Hallelujah. You will see that our Lord Jesus Christ, you know, as he nurtured the disciples, as he nurtured the disciples that were following him, you know, at a point, he said he is no longer calling them servants. He is calling them friends. You know, what that, you know, indicates to me is that Jesus wanted to create an atmosphere. You know, friends are people that interact. Friends are people that they can play. Friends are people that can discuss. Friends are people that can be vulnerable to people, to themselves, without fear. And I discovered that these principles are very important in running a home. There's another scripture I want to also quickly read in 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. It says, likewise, ye husband, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another, love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous, not rendering evil for evil, or railing for railing, but contrary wise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. I discovered that to run a home that will fulfill God's purpose, you must be a friendly husband. You must be able to be a man that is social, you know, to be able to interact with your wife. And I have some little functions here that I want to outline under that. Because the privilege of building a family from the scratch, you know, rests on the man. And it is very, very wonderful. You know, I said the first one is that the man must joyfully be ready to provide basic necessities of life. And this includes adequate food, accommodation, and clothing. And this you must do as a matter of priority. You know, there are so many men that are not providing for their family. And that is never to be mentioned among Christians. Because the Bible said, if you fail to provide for your family, you have denied the faith and you are worse than an unbeliever. So as a real man, it is your responsibility. And when you are doing it, you must do it joyfully. That's why I put it under friendship and social responsibility. You know, there are some people, yeah, because they are providing for their family, they think they are doing something very, very special. There's nothing special about that. It's a critical role, but you must do it joyfully. Because when you provide food for your family, when they are well clothed and when they are looking fine, it brings joy to the family. And I said also, when children begin to come, it is your duty to ensure that they have good education. We have mentioned that earlier on, in order to prepare them for their own future challenges, especially in the socioeconomic sector of the society. You know, it is your duty to ensure that your children go to good schools. And when we talk about good schools, we are not necessarily talking about expensive schools. We are talking about schools where they can learn under the atmosphere of the fear of God. There are so many schools that are expensive, and they don't allow anything about God to be taught there. I don't think it is proper. If you are a believer and you are a real man that God is looking for, you know, apart from your home, the other place where your children ought to learn and ought to grow spiritually is school. So look for schools where the teachers there, they fear God, and they allow the children to have fellowship. They can pray. They can study the word of God at the appropriate time. So, and then, of course, without compromising the academic standard. So it is your duty to ensure that you are, you know, making provision for the good education of your children. And again, under this rule, I say you must make sure that your family is adequately protected from all forms of harassment, especially harassment from maybe your extended family, harassment from relations, harassment from neighbors, and even harassment from criminals. You must keep your eye to make sure that nobody in your family is harassed. They allow their, you know, brothers to harass their children. We have had some reports where even brothers of a man even molested his daughters without the man knowing. That ought not to be so. You must ensure that adequate protection is given to your family to make sure that nobody harass your daughters, nobody harass your sons, because you have that responsibility. Again, I said, be a friendly husband to your wife, a friendly father to your children, and a friendly leader to all members of your household. And that is very important. Yes, we know now to work, to do so many things, and come back to ensure that there is food to eat. But then there is another thing we are saying here, that take time to create a relaxation time. You know, we, in this part of the world, we are not really used to relaxing. We work from January 1st to December 31st. It ought not to be so. There is nothing wrong. It is very important. You see that God, even after he created the world, 6 days, on the seventh day, he rested. As a family man, you must, from time to time, create a relaxation time. Sometimes it is for you and your wife. You just take your wife somewhere to rest and to discuss and to sleep and to pray together and to plan. And then some other time, you take your entire family. You don't have to travel abroad. A camp, you can go to a guest house. You can even go to a family friend that has a bigger community. Just get out of your environment to go and relax, to find time to laugh, to discuss, to play, and to make merry. Very, very important. And even in your house, weekends, you can just decide that, no, we are not going out today. And it is a time to relax, to discuss little things with your children, to play games with them and with your wife and children, so as to make them feel your presence in the home. And I said, make it a habit also to do some celebration. You know, when you look at the Old Testament, there were a lot of celebration that even God prescribed for his children. You know, many, many festivals at different time of the year. It was a time to mix, offer sacrifice to God, thanksgiving and all that. And then after that, you'll be doing merrymaking. And it is part of us, our social responsibility, to celebrate. There's nothing wrong with celebrating your wife's birthday, your children's birthday. It, it doesn't have to be very big. You can celebrate any important event of your life. That is a social responsibility. Just to make your family happy and ensure that your bonding, we are known to always going out without creating time for us to relax. And God is calling us to make some amendment. I also say here that as a man and the father and the husband and the father of the home, any success of your family. For instance, there are meeting, one is doing very well, your wife is promoted, we can celebrate that. You can put compliments. Sometimes we are, we fathers, we do not pay good compliments. We are only criticizing our children when they are not doing very well. But when they do very well, it is also important that we give them good compliments. And this will ensure that, you know, the love flow, that interaction, that friendship we are talking about, continue to flow, and it grows our affection to one another. The last little other responsibility that I have seen that I want to just mention is what I call special responsibility for the real man. You know, that by simply being a man, there are things that you need to do to ensure that there is no omission or there is no loophole in your family. The first thing I say here is that as a man, you must ensure that you pay dowry on your wife. You know, that may sound very, very funny, but we found out that there are so many, many men, including Christians, who are married, but they never did it they didn't do it properly. You know, if you are a man, it is your duty to go and ask your wife's hand in marriage and ensure that all that they required that are not outside the Christian culture, you offer it and ensure that your wife's father or somebody from her family handed her properly over to you. Sometimes we go for couples retreat and we find out that some husbands, they never did that. Maybe they met when they were not yet converted and they were living together as husband and wife. And then they started having children. And now they have become believers, yet they have not taken the right steps to go and pay dowry on their wife. That is not correct. It is your duty. We saw that when Abraham sent his servant to go and marry for Isaac, he went with all the various items that he was going to present as dowries. So I want to ask you to do that in case you have not done that. There was a time we were having a couples forum and we were trying to revisit the matter of vows that we make to our wives during our wedding days. And it was surprising to see some of the women that raised up their hands and they said, we never took any vow. My husband did not took any vow when we were getting married. And we're wondering, what is unique about Christian wedding is the vow. You know, when we are doing wedding, it is not the dressing, it is not the dancing. It is the vow that we make before God and before his people on our wedding day. It's very important. Even if you were not a believer before you got married, now that you are married, there's what we call church blessing. It can be done on any day of the week. Arrange with your pastor, and you make the vow to love, to have, and to own till death do you part. Very, very important. And the other thing I said is very important in a home and as the duty of the wife is the naming of the children. Naming your children must be done deliberately, especially because naming sharpens the direction of their destiny. We discover that even in the New Testament, when Jesus was going to be born, the name that he was going to be called was given to Joseph. The angel appeared to him and said, take Mary to be your wife that child that she is carrying, she will give birth to it, and you shall call him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. And we also saw that even John the Baptist, the angel gave the name to the father, even when the father was not able to talk until the day he was going to be named. He scribbled out, and the people around scribbled it on the paper. He gave it to the people around to give the boy that name. Very, very important. We saw some situation in the Bible whereby women gave names to their children, and those names were circumstantial. They were names of quarrels, like the home of Jacob. You know, you see Leah naming her children, oh, because I was not loved. Oh, maybe my husband will now love me again. Oh, I have given him another son because I have been abandoned. Such names that women give to their children, sometimes they are circumstantial. It is the responsibility of a man to prayerfully give names to their children, names that that will call forth their destiny as they grow in life. Then two more things, and then we'll pray. As a father, I said, it is also your responsibility to pronounce the divine blessings upon your children. We see that, we first saw that in Genesis chapter 9, verse 24 to 27, where Noah, after he recovered from the flood, you know, it happened that he went and got drunk, and one of the children saw his nakedness. The other two, they cover his nakedness. And when he woke up from that experience, the Bible said he pronounced a curse upon the one that that saw his nakedness, and pronounced blessings upon the other ones. And if you look at the history, you will discover that such pronouncements, they normally follow their children, the children. And you will also see that in the family of Jacob, in Genesis chapter 49, we saw that before he died, he gathered all his children and he told them what was going to happen to them in their journey. So, very, very important that as a father, that role is well executed. You pronounce blessings upon your children on a, you know, on regular basis. That role, even though mothers pray for their children, but the role of pronouncing the divine blessing upon their children, it rests upon the father. We also saw that example between Isaac and Rebecca. Lastly, I said a father and a husband, as a real man, you must play a leading role in event of any danger to rescue and rehabilitate your family. Like in our days where sometimes there are political crises, there are religious crises, your role is to rescue, first of all, rescue your family and take them to a safe place and make sure that they are well rehabilitated until the situation returns to normal. So, having said all this, you will discover that to be a real man is something that God is requiring from each and every one of us. In this end time, when God is restoring all things, preparing the church for the rapture, for the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, God is calling us to rise up as priests in our homes, to rise up as fathers in our homes, to rise up to make sure that our homes run well, so that when the master comes for us, all of us, every member of our household, you know, we were able to present them spotless and presentable on that day of judgment. None of us must miss the rapture. None of us must be found wanting on the other side, because God has given us the responsibilities. He has given us all that we need in order to succeed. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord help us to succeed in this wondrous task before us as real men. Let us pray. Our Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you for this time again that you have outlined for us, these little functions that is expected of us as real men. Again, we are looking up to you. Jesus has told us that without him, we can do nothing. And so we are asking, Lord Jesus, help each and every one of us who are being expected to play all this role, Lord, we are asking that none of us will be found wanting in our homes. Each and every one of us must succeed, first of all, in our homes, so that when you assign us a duty in the public, like we were being taught yesterday, we will